So what is this field of biodiversity informatics? I'll start this off by saying these are my opinions. And ideally what this will result in is some conversation, maybe even some debate, and ideally even some disagreement. So this is opinion, not fact, and I hope that you all will treat it as such. I will put up with this presentation an electronic copy of a paper that some colleagues and I prepared a couple years ago. But essentially, the idea was this, what are the big questions in biodiversity informatics? And it actually becomes kind of a curious situation because we have a field that has evolved very quickly and has accumulated considerable activity, and yet it doesn't always know what its questions are. If we were talking phylogenetics, we know that the question is, what is the history of life? Well, in biodiversity informatics, we don't always know what the questions are. I'll come back to this point in a little bit. Let's start out with some definitions. Wikipedia defines informatics as a broad academic field encompassing human-computer interaction, information science, blah, 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 blah. Bioinformatics, this is another curious term, an interdisciplinary field that develops improved methods for storing, retrieving, organizing, and analyzing biological data. We'll come back to that next to the last word. And then biodiversity informatics, a very useless definition, the application of informatics techniques to biodiversity information. So I would change these definitions a little bit. I would suggest to you that informatics goes beyond just human-computer interactions, and I'll show you a little bit of the informatics that preceded human-computer interactions. Bioinformatics was defined broadly. Remember, it said biological data. But in point of fact, that term bioinformatics has been essentially grabbed up by exclusively molecular aspects of biological informatics. And so I'd suggest to you that biodiversity informatics essentially takes that whole organismal level of biological informatics. I would broaden the definition that I just showed you slightly because I think data capture is another critical component because we have such massive challenges in capturing data. We'll come back to that point at several points during this week. Just to illustrate the point about bioinformatics, I took the table of contents from the Wikipedia entry about bioinformatics. And you can see major research areas, sequence analysis, genome annotation, guess what? It's all genomics and proteomics. And no ecosystems, no species, no nothing that is above the organismal level. As far as biodiversity informatics, we actually have a lot of biodiversity informatics institutions that have been in existence for decades and even centuries. My favorite is the last one, which has been around for about 300 years. So these institutions obviously predate computers, but they really were making every effort to manage information about biodiversity. This is just some scenes around where I work, the bird collection of the University of Kansas. It starts with actually live animals. This is a freezer full of dead animals that have accumulated. Those get prepared into specimens of various types. In a bird collection, it's a mixture of skins and skeletons and specimens preserved in formalin. There's a skeleton, and the important thing that I want you to notice is this. It's an aluminum tab with an identifier, and that links to catalogs. And the catalogs have these very organized Braak paper and India ink, just the way 19th century ornithologists did. We do take computers into the field with us, but it's always, quote unquote, backed up by these less breakable technologies. Thankfully, we've abandoned our paper catalogs for the museum, but this was in use until about 1997. Each of those is a ledger that includes an entry for each specimen. We have about 120,000 bird specimens in the collection, so you can imagine how many person hours were spent sitting at that ledger writing. Field notes would get made in the field, organized and bound, and they're kept literally in a safe. And the idea is that even if the museum burns down, the safe sinks four stories to the ground level and can be recovered. None of us believes that, but that's the idea. And here are the actual specimens. And you can see each one has a label attached to it. The labels are now quite full of information. Those are egg specimens. That's a 19th century egg collection. There are specimens in formalin. Skin specimens, those are from Southeast Asia. And the actual cabinets where the specimens are held. I'm showing you this not in any assertion that we should spend any time talking about this in this course, but rather just to remind us all that the informatics goes way back and has components that come before the computational side. Any one of my colleagues in the systematics field could give you a similar slideshow of how information is managed for an insect collection or a herpetological collection. So I'll give you a more general definition. Biodiversity informatics is the application of informatics techniques to biodiversity information for improved capture, cleaning, management, improvement, analysis, and interpretation. So it's kind of an exciting time right now because we have so much technology and potential for doing interesting things with these data, but there's still a lot left to do. So we have now very efficient technologies for capturing data. This is a workstation for capturing botanical specimens, insect specimens. We have a lot of possibility for enabling curation. You're going to hear a lot about this this week. This is an example from Brazil, which has put a lot of time into its herbarium collections. And I fell in love with this because there are about 3.5 million records of Brazilian plants now online. Very well organized by collection. You can see which ones are georeferenced, which ones are imaged. And when there are images, you can do things like put the image of the type on one side and the image of the plant that you're trying to identify on the other side. And then there are modules for capturing these data that are associated. It's a very, very exciting, essentially potential for doing a lot with very rich information that's associated with systematic specimens. You're going to hear a lot more about automated georeferencing. So I'm just going to breeze right by that because there are people who know a lot more about that than me here. There are modules for cleaning data in an automated sense. You can see some very dirty things happening here with data. Those are all Brazilian records that are digitally enabled at present. This is a module developed by a two arrows that are zero longitude. And this is kind of neat. These are plots of numbers of errors of different types through time. And so you see here is a type of error that has been accumulating. No, sorry, that's the total number of records in the data set. But you can see here with duplicate records and with suspicious generic names, you can see that somebody came in and started cleaning and got rid of all of those problematic records. It's a very exciting time as far as integration of data. I'm giving you all Brazilian examples because I spent my sabbatical last year in Brazil. But we can integrate data on massive scales. This is the Brazilian network. Essentially, all of these are satellite institutions that contribute data, which are then served out of a city called Campinas, but that's now moving to another city, which is the capital of Brasilia. But essentially, just in Brazil, 250 collections, 5.2 million records online, of which a little bit less than half are georeferenced, and they tell us something about approximately 400,000 names. Now you're going to realize that that doesn't mean we're talking about 400,000 species, but that's a lot of information. And I'm sure you will hear about essentially the next steps, which several of the people at this table have been involved in, but essentially new ideas and new technologies for data integration. So we have all of these new possibilities, but again, what are the challenges? I'm going to give you a quick example from Mexico. This is the Atlas of the Distribution of Mexican Birds. And this is essentially an illustration of why, which is to say, what do we gain from this? Mexico got its biodiversity informatics house in order beginning about three decades ago. And remember, I'm a bird person, so I'll give you maybe bird examples. But beginning in the 1980s, a group started assembling bibliography. And I remember quite clearly the first day I spent in the Museum of the National University in 1988, when I asked about a certain piece of literature, and the answer was, well, here's the citation, but no, we don't have a copy. And so this was an effort to solve that problem. And so you can see this first edition of the Bibliography of Mexican Birds covered 1825, which is the earliest publication that we've found, up to 1992. And it put together several thousand literature references. And along the way, we accumulated photocopies of all of those papers. And that changed ornithology in Mexico. Similarly, we needed to know what was known about Mexican birds. And so several of my Mexican colleagues and I participated in that. Assembled the Atlas of the Distribution of Mexican Birds. And so we now have a database, it's centralized, it's not very modern, but it's very clean and very, very useful. But it's a database that documents more than 420,000 occurrences of the 1,000 or so species of Mexican birds. So what did that mean? Well, I want to give you some summary statistics. Here are the numbers of records from the early 1800s to the 21st century. And what you can see is that very little was happening in the early and middle 19th century. A lot of activity began in the late 19th century. And then the 20th century saw quite a bit of activity fairly constantly through the century. If we look at cumulative numbers of records, you see we now have 400 some thousand records. And a century ago, we had maybe a tenth of that. Now, there's some really interesting things, and I think some of these same phenomena would apply to any of the countries where you all come from. If I take those 420,000 records and look at where the specimen is housed, well, those that are in green, white, and red up at the upper right, that's the colors of the Mexican flag, those are housed in Mexican institutions. And all the rest of them, from here to here, all of the rest of those are housed in museums in almost exclusively Europe and North America. Now, there's a really interesting temporal